Christ himself carried our sins in his body to the cross, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. He committed no sin, and no one ever heard a lie come from his lips. When he was insulted, he did not answer back with an insult. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but placed his hopes in God, the righteous judge. It is by his wounds that we have been healed. We were like sheep that had lost our way, but now we have been brought back to follow the shepherd and keeper of our souls. Come, let us behold and worship the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray that we might find strength and comfort in the cross of Christ. Almighty and merciful God, we thank you for bringing life and peace for us through the shame, suffering, and death of your Son. Teach us to boast about nothing but the cross of Christ, where our life is restored and sin's power is broken. Strengthen us so that we may walk the way of the cross as your disciples. Grow us in faith and keep us trusting in your mercy. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. And just a word before we sing the first hymn. The service today, we will remain seated for pretty much the whole service, except near the end where we will stand for the prayer for mercy. But even during the reading of the gospel, we remain seated during that time. Our service today is a mixture of Bible readings and hymns, and then the sermon and prayers interspersed there as well. We sing the song, When Our Life Began Again.
Jesus, where are you? The first reading for today, Good Friday, is written in chapter 53 of Isaiah, beginning at verse 1. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And who can speak of his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people, he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer, and through the Lord makes his life a guilt offering. He will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
For me, by that I was.
The second reading for today is written in chapter 10 of Hebrews, beginning at verse 16. This is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts and I will write them on their minds. Then he adds, their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. And where these have been forgiven, there is no longer any sacrifice for sin. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is, his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. This is the word of the Lord.
Christ, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. Being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. This Good Friday is a long reading covering a couple chapters of the Gospel according to John, and we will intersperse it with several verses of a hymn and then a moment of silence at the appropriate time. John chapter 18, beginning at verse 28. Then the Jewish leaders took Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, they did not enter the palace because they wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," they objected. This took place to fulfill what Jesus had said about the kind of death he was going to die. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "Your own people and chief priests handed you over to me. What is it you've done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You're a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" retorted Pilate. With this, he went out again to the Jews gathered there and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him, but it's your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" And they shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in an uprising. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they slapped him in the face. Once more Pilate came out and said to the Jews gathered there, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him." The Jewish leaders insisted, "We have a law, and according to that law, he must die because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid, and he went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus. But Jesus gave no answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said. "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jewish leaders kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar." When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out, sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the stone pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. It was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away! Take him away and crucify him!" "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. We sing the first two verses of O Sacred Head.
Thank you.
So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull. And there they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but write that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews." Pilate answered them, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarment remaining. This garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. "Let's not tear it," they said to one another. "Let's decide by lot who will get it." This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled that said, "They divided my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment." So this is what the soldiers did. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple he said, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. And when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jewish leaders did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe. These things happened so that the scripture would be fulfilled. It says, "Not one of his bones will be broken." And as another scripture says, "They will look on the one they have pierced." Later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. Taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices in strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. Because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty Lord, as we ponder the magnitude of your sacrifice, help us to look to Christ alone for our peace, hope, and salvation. Amen. Australia's first ever state funeral was held in 1863. For the explorers Burke and Wills. Burke and Wills were the first people to cross this land from south to north. And when news reached Melbourne of their death and that they were buried on the Cooper, then a debate raged about the proper residing place for the bodies and bones of these heroes of Australia. And so it was decided that they would be reburied with honour in Melbourne. So Alfred Howitt, who was the one who had found them and buried them at Cooper's Creek, was sent back to retrieve their bodies. It was a custom of the day at that time that at a funeral that souvenirs would be displayed from the people who had died. And so there was some locks of hair, there was specimens of the Nadu plant from their last campsite, and these items travelled with them as they took the bodies back to Melbourne. But on that return journey, Howitt was met in almost every town with crowds eager to pay their respect to these explorers. Back in Melbourne then, when they arrived, their remains lay in the Royal Society Hall for 2 weeks as people came for a viewing. And over 100,000 people came to do so. And that's an incredibly staggering number considering that Melbourne's population at that time was 120,000. This country of ours has a history of state funerals and memorial services to celebrate particular individuals and their contribution that they've made to our nation. So Jørn Utzon, the architect who designed the Sydney Opera House, had such a state funeral in 2009, as did Charles Perkins and Donald Bradman and many others. Last week it was Michael Gudinski, the iconic Australian music producer, who had a state funeral in Melbourne. And at each of those events, the focus is always upon what those people did and what they accomplished in their lifetime. And for them and for us, when it comes to death, that signals the end of all of our achievements. We're not going to achieve anything once we're in the grave. But by contrast, on Good Friday, we remember that the greatest accomplishment of Jesus actually happened when he died. So Good Friday is not a memorial service to remember and celebrate the things that he achieved in his life. You know, as numerous and as worthy of celebration as those things might be, but it's to ponder and to reflect upon his crowning achievement, which is his death upon a cross, which won the greatest victory of all. You know, many people experience tragedy in their lives, and we probably all know someone whose life was cut tragically short. I think of the four teenagers from my high school who lost control of their vehicle. I think of the 2.5-year-old toddler that I buried in New South Wales after a health battle. But with the death of Jesus, it's not a life that's been cut short. It's not some tragic accident. It's the result of his total obedience, his utter faithfulness to doing the will of God. And so the ending of his earthly life, it doesn't mean that there was an unsuccessful ending to his mission. In fact, it was the fulfillment, it was the culmination of his whole mission and purpose. It was part of God's plan for the world, the salvation of the world, rescuing us from what is due us. So death didn't stop him from achieving his purpose. In fact, death was central to his purpose. And through it, he defeated those three great foes. He defeated sin itself. He defeated death, which comes from sin. And then he defeated our accuser, the devil. Jesus willingly chose to die, to give up his life for us. You know, he could have walked away, could have come down from the cross at any point on that day. And he was taunted with that possibility right to the very end. The people shouted out to him, "He saved others, but he can't save himself. Come down from the cross if you're the Son of God." But there was something so deep within him that compelled him, so intrinsic to his saving plan, that it compelled him to continue through the suffering, through the torture, through the abuse, to the bitter end. You know, often the pictures that we see of Jesus in the children's storybooks and so on, we see Jesus sentimentalized, a warm glow on his face, but not this time. Crucifixion, it's designed to maximize the hurt and the suffering. The back that is lacerated from the whipping. The excruciating pain of the thorns and the nails. The stinging and burning in the arms and the legs as the weight of the body tears at the nails. There's no one to wipe away the blood and the sweat as it trickles into the eyes. There's nowhere to hide away from the shame of being naked in public, put to death with common criminals. There's no remorse, there's no compassion, there's no pity from the Roman soldiers. They'd done this 1,000 times. And it wasn't a triumphant death like some others. Jesus dies alone, forsaken. Literally, the weight of the world's sin and brokenness is upon his shoulders. Jesus dies with an anguished cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? The truth is that Jesus went to the cross because of us, because of what we've done, because of our sin and our willful rebellion against God. That's what nailed him there. Justice needed to be done. Someone needed to pay for all the things we have done to each other and to God. And so our sermon text today from Isaiah 53 describes that. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our wickedness. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each one of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the sin of us all. Now, perhaps the most well-known artistic work of the artist Rembrandt is his print of the three crosses, and it depicts the crucifixion scene. And when you look at that print, the first your attention is firstly drawn, rightly so, to the cross in the middle of it, a light shining from heaven over the cross. And then those that are further away from the cross are shrouded in increasing layers of darkness. And under that light, you can see those around the foot of the cross, those who were crucifying him, the expressions on their faces, the people who were watching on with anguished looks. But as you eventually start looking at the edges of the print and you see shadowy figures there, almost hidden, and one of them is a representation of Rembrandt himself, who often drew himself into his works. And this was his way of indicating that he was there, that his sins nailed Jesus to the cross. Maybe you've heard that song, and those of you who were here last night did. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? And the answer is we sure were. As surely as if we had driven those nails in ourselves. It's our guilt that caused him to suffer. Our godlessness, our rebellion, our indifference, our betrayals. And each one of us must admit, and one day everyone in the world will admit, that I shed the sacred blood of Christ. I nailed him to the tree. I crucified God's Son. And so as we hear of his hands outstretched, his palms pierced by spikes, we remember the things that we've done with our hands, the things we've stolen, the accusing fingers that we've pointed at others, the people that maybe we've stretched out our hands to hurt, or the times when we've withheld our hands from helping someone. As we reflect on Christ's tongue sticking to the roof of his mouth, tasting that sour wine, crying out, "I thirst," we remember how we misuse our tongues. The harsh words, the cruel names, the coarse jokes, the lies, the slanders, the blasphemy that have rolled off our lips over the years. As we ponder the heart of Christ, the spear thrust through it, a flow of water and blood coming from it, we remember the blackness of our own hearts, our evil thoughts and desires which lurk there, the selfishness, the greed. Yes, on Good Friday, we remember that Jesus suffered and died because of the things that we did and because of the things that we failed to do. And yet, even though Jesus died because of us, more importantly, and this, if you take anything from this sermon today, I want you to remember and hear above all else that Jesus did this for you. Jesus Christ did this in your place so that you could be made holy, so that you could have eternal life with the Father, so that you could have true hope, that you could have a future beyond this life, beyond death. All of this is given to us through Christ. You know, during World War I, the Prince of Wales went to visit 36 severely wounded soldiers in the outskirts of London in the hospital there. And the Prince and his party that was with him, they went through the ward and they shook the hands of each of those men. But when they were about to leave, the Prince indicated he'd only seen 30 of the men and he asked, "Where are the others?" And he was informed that the others were extremely severe cases, and so they were in a different section of the ward. He demanded to see them. And so he was shown another 5 men who were maimed and battered by the war. And he said, "Where's the last one?" And he was told that the grotesque nature of this man's appearance was unbearable, but the Prince of Wales demanded to see this man. He stood there near the soldier's bed and just looked in silence, and then he moved towards the man. He stooped down and he kissed him, and in a breaking voice he said, "He was wounded for me." He realized the depth of sacrifice that this man had made for him and for his country, for his freedom and for his sake. And that's what our sermon text today also tells us. Yes, it was because of us, but it was also for us. Our Lord Jesus was pierced for us. He was crushed for us. Punishment was upon him so that we could have his shalom, his peace. It's by his wounds that we are healed, by his stripes, as the Hebrew says. And so Jesus died for you. He died for all people. He died for sinners. No one is excluded. Christ's love includes you and everyone. And his merciful love meant that Jesus took our place, bearing all the righteous anger and wrath of God upon human sinfulness. He took it on himself, took it in his body. He did it so that we would no longer have to bear the weight of God's judgment. And while death is always ugly, the good news that flows to us from the cross is that through his sacrifice, we are healed at the core of our being. By the death of Christ, you are mended. Your brokenness is mended. You are forgiven. You are declared holy by the blood of Christ. And that impenetrable chasm that separated us from God, it's been bridged by Christ, by his death. You now have peace with God. The death of Jesus accomplishes that for you. And Jesus willingly gives that to you as his gift, so that you and me, so that the whole world can share in his kingdom, his life, his family. You know, we can know all of the historical facts about Good Friday and believe them to be true, but the greatest truth is this, that whatever he did it for you. He did it because of you. The crowning achievement of his life was his death for our sins, the glorious coronation of our Lord and Saviour and King. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Amen. I believe that we are receiving your offerings at this point. Yes, we are. As we sing together the song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
It was my sin that held me there.
As we pray each petition, there will be a moment of silence for you to add your own petition and then the response. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Let us pray for the Holy Church of God throughout the world, that God, our Almighty and loving Father, will grant peace to his church, preserve it in unity, and protect it throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the leaders of God's church, both national and state, as well as all Christians in their daily vocations. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for all those who do not yet believe in Jesus Christ, that the light of the Holy Spirit will show them the way of salvation. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for those who serve us in public office, that God may use them to curb what is evil and work for the well-being of our nation and community. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for all people of the earth who are in need of healing, strength, support, and loving care, that God will provide for them according to their needs. Lord, in your mercy, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. stand for the prayer for mercy. We are all born weak and helpless, all lead the same short, troubled life. We grow and wither as quickly as flowers, we disappear like shadows. O Lord God most holy, O Lord God most mighty, for the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. In the midst of life we are in death. To whom can we go for help but to you, Lord God, though you are rightly displeased because of our sins. O Lord God most holy, O Lord God most mighty, for the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. You know the secrets of our hearts. Mercifully hear us, most worthy Judge eternal. Keep us at our last hour in the consolation of your love. O Lord God most holy, O Lord God most mighty, for the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. O Lord God, your mercies are always new. Give us the spirit of your dear Son, that in the day of judgment we may stand in your presence as your forgiven people despite our sin, as your faithful people despite our failures, and as those who have been claimed by your Son through faith, although we have not deserved him. On that day, may the same Christ who has redeemed our lives also plead our cause before your throne of grace. In his name we pray. Amen. We sit as we sing the hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Send down your rich blessing on us as we remember the suffering and death of your Son. Grant us pardon and comfort so that we may be assured of our eternal salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The God of love and peace, be with you now and always. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you. By your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.